So, hope you guys had time to have a look at all the built-in data types in Python. So first thing, we start with numbers. Of course, we have int, float, complex, decimals, fraction, all the kinds of object types. Strings can be taken as numbers. String as a single object. List is another single type of object. We'll discuss lists and dictionaries, and of course, tuples also. Tuples will not discuss much, more like lists only, but have some specific functionalities which we hardly use in data science. So yeah. So when it comes to numbers, there are normal integers, long integers, floating point, octal and hexagon representation, and complex numbers. So all these data types are possible. Generally, we in Python, we always use int and float, not more than that. We don't come across floating, or of course, floating is also comes into picture when the numbers are very small, but or in points, we don't come across octal or hexal, literals and complex numbers. Right. So let's start with initializing a variable. I think you guys have initialized it already yesterday. A is equal to 3, print A. And you can also do type of A, which indicates what is its type actually. How is Python saving it? If you have a, then other programming languages, generally C or Java requires initialization of variables, saying, hey, I want a variable I, allocate some memory, allocate a type int or something like that. Whereas in Python, it's dynamic in nature. You can just type a variable name and assign it with some value, and Python by default tries to understand what is it. For example, if I say D is equal to 3.14, and of course I can print B, right? And look at type of B, how the Python tries to save it as, right? In the same way, you can also convert one format to another format. Let's say A is our int, right? So you can write it as A, that's good, changed is equal to float. Type, this particular thing is called typecasting, where you forcibly convert the data type, and you can say A underscore changed, it show you 3.0, and look at type of A underscore changed has become a float. Ideally A was your int, but I made it forcibly change into float of A. Similarly, you can do the same thing on floats also. For example, B, right? B underscore changed, you can put it as int of B, and you can type B changed. It's rounded, because if you want an int, it has to be an integer. So what Python is explicitly doing is like it's rounding it to zero number. Ideally B is 3.41, but B changed has become 3 because you wanted B changed as int of B. Understood, guys? Three things we learned: naming a variable, initializing a variable, printing it out, and looking at a type of it, and also change the format of it into different type by forcibly changing it. Try it out, everyone, and let me know if you have any concerns. The same thing we have done here itself also. Try it out and let me know once you're done. In case you have any issues, you can ping me or Mani. Manikanta is there on the session. You can directly chat with him. If you're facing issues, let me know. I can stop the screen share and help you out. All right, thanks. Please keep giving me feedback whether you're done or not so that I get to know. Perfect. Yeah, I was wondering. So the next thing is expression operators. I hope you remember this Bode-Moss principle, brackets, then multiplication, then division and all, which happens first A into B plus C or A into B plus C and all. I'll not go further into it, but you can try it out different possibilities. I mean, as a class task, you can evaluate 6 into 7 plus 9 and 6 into 7 plus 9. Generally, when you do real compute, you try to put as many brackets so that it's clearly understood. Right. So now we'll get into lists. Lists are the most flexible ordered collection of data types in Python. Lists can contain any sort of object in general. You can place anything and everything into a list, but with a given syntax. Right? So we'll start with a small list and do some list operations. And of course, when you go to real life data science examples, we'll more deal with NumPy arrays as well as pandas data frames. Of course, NumPy arrays and NumPy arrays are based built on Python lists only, and pandas data frames are built on NumPy arrays. But having a good understanding of lists will make your when you start doing your problem statements in data, it makes it very easier to code. And NumPy arrays and lists have a lot of syntax and operations in common. Perfect. Let's initialize our first list. How to initialize a list? Again, just go give the name of list and you can randomly put the elements into the list. First of all, brackets, square brackets always, and each of the elements should be separated by a comma. That's the syntax of the list. In case you're putting strings inside a list, you need a single inverted commas. It's a mandatory. If you're putting in numbers, it's fine. You don't need to put inverted commas or quotes, single quotes. But in case you are doing a strings, you have to do it. So go ahead, start practice notebook, and let's say series. I am doing. Of course, in case some brand, okay, city course, if I'm putting it as 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, you can always execute it. Whereas city, you have to initialize it, brackets and single inverted commas are mandatory, otherwise it will throw an error. Type it out, guys. Just don't copy it. If you copy it, you'll forget the syntax. So if you like to, there is an interesting problem statement I have. Make a list of all the Android versions you can remember. You can make that also as a list. And the first thing you can do as a list operation is the length of the list. By the way, to make programming easy, we can actually use something called tab. If you are already programmers, guys, tab will let you auto-complete your code. So I write L and I press tab. It will show all the possible functions with L. I can select it. Now again, I type C and type tab, and it shows all possible variable names. So it's like the classic autocomplete in WhatsApp, but we programmers at least don't have that privilege. It tries to autocomplete, but you can always use the tab key. If you press the tab key, all possible variable names will come in the thing. You can do it. Then click shift enter. So length of the cities is 5. Okay, guys, initialize it and try the length of cities. And of course, you guys keep the course module open so that you can have a reference to all this sheet. Let me know once you're done. We can go for Python indexing. All right, great. Perfect. And the next path we will study about is indexing and slicing of a list. So Python indexing, what do you mean by indexing? That means it's a way the computer or the programming language stores your list with an index, let's say the numbers, to know which element is which and all. So it's easy to isolate and print it out. Python indexing starts from zero. That means Mumbai is assigned zero, Hyderabad is assigned one, and Delhi is assigned two. Python Pune is three, and Chennai is four. Remember, indexing of Python starts with zero. It doesn't start with one. All right. So if you have to print an element in you have to be like, so cities of one will not print Mumbai, it will print Hyderabad. If you want Mumbai, it's zero. Cities of zero. That's how your indexing works. There is also negative indexing. Negative indexing is nothing but counting from reverse. I'll show you. If this is zero, this is one, this is two, three, and four, this will be also minus one, minus two, minus three, and minus four, and minus five. That's how Python indexing from reverse works. When you put a minus, Python starts to count from backside or the end. And essentially, there's no minus zero. That's why reverse indexing always starts with minus one, minus two, minus three, minus four, minus five. Pretty much useful in case you want to get elements from the last. You need not know the length and figure out what is the last index. You can just last but one, you can just put last minus two. Right, so cities of minus one, print it out, you'll get Chennai. Right, now the next part of indexing is just slicing the list. You don't want only one element, you want multiple elements. Then you can put something called as colon, start element and end element. Start element and end element. So I want 0, 2, 3. It will show Mumbai, Hyderabad, and Delhi. So this particular slicing has a catch. 0 is included and 3 is excluded. What do you mean by included and excluded? When I say cities of 0 to 3, that means I'll get cities of 0, cities of 1, of 2, 3 is not included. The first element, the starting index is always included, ending index is always excluded. All the counting happens in Python counting. That means it starts from 0. Don't do your counting. All the counting will start from Python count. Right, so try it out, guys. And okay, just one final thing. You can also do cities of, let's say I want mention the start index and I'll say three, still it works, Mumbai, Hyderabad. When something is not mentioned in the start index, especially in the slicing, it considers zeros. And I say, I don't mention ending index and two, and close it, it goes till the end. By the way, two is included, right? 0, 1, 2, Delhi. Raj, I'll come to that. A negative index is a class task for you. Go ahead and try. It should work, yeah. It will work also, it will work. Negative index also works. Guys, try it out, all the possible indexes. Yeah. Try it out, everyone. And let me know once you're done. Okay, where minus one is not inclusive. Yeah, the starting is in start. Not X. Okay. Okay, let me try it out. So I think, yeah, it's not inclusive always. The ending index is never inclusive. That's what Vams is saying now. Sunil, if we don't know the number of elements in the list, minus one gives the last element. Yes, exactly. When using the negative indexing, how do I get to the first? Okay. I mean, Sunil, you want the first element when you are doing in the last, then you should know the length of it. Or better do positive index like zero. You get the first element. Okay, minus 3 to 1. Okay, let's see the output. First of all, it is of minus 3 to -1. Right. Let's, okay. First of all, let me print cities. Right, tell me the indexes from -1, -2, -3, -4, and -5. When you say -3, starting index is always inclusive. -3 is Delhi, this is printed. Then -2, Pune is printed. -1 is Chennai, it's not printed because this is included, this is excluded. Starting index is always included, that's why Delhi is printed. Ending index is never included, that's why the Chennai is not printed. Clear, Pooja? Yeah, I'm gonna explain that step size money, yeah. Do cities of 4 to 1. Raj, you can put a higher index in the start and a lower index in the end. That creates a problem, might be. Now, guys, there is one more thing I didn't tell you. There's a step also here. So cities of, let's say, when you're doing 1, 2, 4, I can also give the third input here. I didn't teach you this in the previous one, which I wanted to teach you now. You can put a step of 2 here. That means every second element will be printed, not every element. Look at the output. Hyderabad and Pune. Just try to see what is the index. 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. When I say 1, 2, 4, what should be printed? 1, 2, 3. Hyderabad, Delhi, and Pune should be printed. But it's not printing Delhi because we gave a step of 2. When you mean tell a step of 2, the first element is printed, the next is skipped, and the next one is printed. Again, next is skipped, and next one is printed. But here we don't have anything, so it didn't print you. Step is an useful function when you want alternate elements or any such logic. So when you don't mention step, it's always taken as 1, but when you mention it, it's always taken. Cities of, let's say, 0 to 4 and do step. So Mumbai and Delhi. Chennai doesn't come because we picked 4. 4 is not excluded. If you want everything, so you can put cities, I can stop, then it will print Chennai. Why did it print Chennai this time? Because you asked it to go till the end. You didn't specify 4. When you specify 4, 4 is not included. Anything which comes in the ending index is always not included. Right? Try it out with step function. Everyone, try it out with step function. Okay. What is that error throwing? If you want in, okay, you want to print in reverse order. Okay. each element wise, or I think see, the order never goes in reverse, because even if you count from reverse, the printing, see, Python has a direction in storage, right? It's always this. If you are printing, it will only print the list in this format. Just because you gave a negative index, that doesn't print Chennai, Pune, Delhi. It's not possible because the structure is not changing. If you want like that, you have to write a list comprehension, change it to new list. Because lists are, list indexes are fixed. Indexing doesn't change the positions. Is that possible with negative negative step? Money, I didn't try. Let me try it out. Series of yeah, exactly. You can't print it in reverse because the list index doesn't change. With minus one step, I'm not sure. Cities of, let's say, let me try minus five, minus one, and the step of minus one. Is it working? Yeah, it's not working. Yep. Yeah, exactly. It doesn't change. It doesn't work. The most probable reason should be that indexing cannot change.
That's it.
Because it always goes this side. So negative index is only way to travel for you intuitively backwards, but Python doesn't travel backwards. Right. And of course, there are some task class tasks here. Yeah, Raj, we will discuss that. There's a mechanism to, you can write a list comprehension. I know that because I haven't taught you yet. Once we go to list comprehension, we can do that. Okay. That's working. Minus one to minus five. Sorry. Interesting. Every time I'll, just a moment. Wow, there's a possible chance you can do it. Minus one, minus five. Okay. Start index is minus one, end index is minus five, and then you, okay. Got it. So you can do it. Super, Parnika. So it's better to ask Python than to ask me. Right. So this is also possible, reversing a list without any list comprehension. You can just do it with indexing.